Too much glucose is toxic, especially to the cells that struggle to control just how much glucose comes in. Now, for the record, that isn't every cell. Most cells actually have sophisticated systems to manage just how much sugar swirls in. So, for example, a muscle cell can use the sugar or stash it away for the next sprint for the bus or that 90-minute Zumba class. When there isn't going to be much of a call for that sugar, it closes the door, making the excess sugar someone else's problem. The someone else is insulin, and he makes a plan to get the sugars out of the circulation and stored away safely. Of course, his solution to the problem does have ripple effects, and this problem solution compounds over time, both on the outside and the inside. We're accustomed to blaming cholesterol for cardiovascular problems because cholesterol is the molecule that is seen. But it takes two to tango, and sugar molecules are right there in the thick of things, along with a crazy busy overwhelmed insulin who is actively being resisted. Now, the cells with the most options are liver cells, since they are sugar processing hubs. In addition to burning sugars for fuel and storing them as glycogen, liver cells can do a little chemical finikere and turn the sugar into fat. Fatty liver disease, anyone? But it's the cells that can't handle the sugar that suffer the most. They choke on the sticky onslaught. The eyes, the kidney, the nerves. These are the organs that suffer significant harms when glycemic control goes out the window. And saving the vulnerable is the mission, which is why doctors focus their attention on glycemic control. Sugar levels must be kept in a normal range. Deviations can cause damage. Now, to manage sugar levels appropriately, you must monitor just how much glucose the average at-risk cell is experiencing. Logic says the easiest way to do this is to measure the amount of sugar in the blood. But it's complicated. First off, it hurts, and it's time-sensitive, because glucose levels oscillate as the body manages sugar availability based on supply and demand. Yes, the management is pretty ineffectual in someone with type 2 diabetes, but it's not non-existent. Insulin does eventually show up and the sugars are cleared. The point is, timing is important. To keep tabs on the sugar levels, you need to time your testing perfectly. Now, this is something that the professional diabetic is trained to do. Anyone who is managing their diabetes with insulin is issued with a blood glucose meter or hooked up to a continuous glucose monitoring device. This precision is not nice to have. It's a necessity. Getting the insulin mix wrong can kill you. But glucose meters are not part of the kit for ordinary folks. And they're also often not considered a necessity for the diabetic who's managing their diabetes with glucose-lowering meds, because the risk of a hypo is quite low, which leaves the dilemma. How does your doctor know what is going on when you arrive at his office at 10:30 a.m. on a Wednesday morning? The spot blood test is out. Your doctor could ask you to come back tomorrow, fasted, and have you do an oral glucose tolerance test, or an OGTT for short. But this would take time and would mean more time off from work, more angst, and it actually might miss that 9:30 p.m. spike. Enter the Haemoglobin A1c test, or HbA1c for short. Join us for this episode of Better Body Chemistry TV as we look at the pros and cons of the HbA1c test and contemplate when its results might be compromised, impacting your health and happiness. Better Body Chemistry TV is brought to you by Dr. Sandy, a scientist turned gremlin buster, helping you battle sugar gremlins, heifer lumps, and other health horribles through better body chemistry. Remember, small things can make a big difference to your health. So, the HbA1c test, well, it's a simple blood test that can be done any time of day or night, which tells the story of sugar exposures, not just in the moment, but for the last 3 months. The sugar exposure is that of the red blood cell, an easily accessible set of cells. Okay, easy doesn't mean painless. On paper, at least, it's perfect. Red blood cells can stand proxy for the cells that are virtually impossible to access. So what is the deal? Red blood cells aren't officially vulnerable to glucose damage. In fact, they run on it. They are one of the few cells that don't have a choice. They run their biology by splitting sugar in the process of glycolysis, and that sugar swirls in via the GLUT1 gate. The GLUT1 gate offers no resistance. So how much sugar enters is directly proportional to how much sugar is in the circulation. And when the sugar gets inside, thanks to a little chemistry, it can leave a mark. The point is, hemoglobin gets glycated. Now, the job of hemoglobin is to carry oxygen around the body. And structurally, hemoglobin is made of 4 proteins, 2 alpha and 2 beta chains. It turns out the beta chains have a valine amino acid right on the end of the chain, and it is this spot where the chemistry happens. Now, there's nothing particularly special about the beta globin protein. Sugars are reactive, and most proteins have vulnerable spots that can and do take a hit. But in most cases, these changes are extremely hard to measure, because the concentration of the particular protein is low and the number of jammed on sugars is tiny. It's like looking for a needle in a haystack. But red blood cells are effectively bags of hemoglobin, and this is what makes them useful. The fact that there is lots and lots of hemoglobin changes the dimensions of the needle and the haystack. It becomes possible to measure the number of hemoglobin molecules with a sugar jammed on. Under normal conditions, around 1 in 20 of the globins has been glycated. That translates to about 5%. If sugar levels are higher, this number rises in proportion to the increased sugar level. And so, the HbA1c gives us a way to spy on sugar exposures across the whole body. It works like a charm. As long as your red blood cells and hemoglobin levels are normal. But if they're not, interpreting the results of this test is challenging and on occasion can lead to the wrong diagnosis. One situation where the HbA1 test is problematic is in people suffering from an iron deficiency. I'll explore this more in a future video, but in the meantime, be aware that the HbA1c test should never be the only test used to diagnose diabetes and or monitor your glycemic control. It is a very important piece of the puzzle, but it is just that, a piece. When it comes to creating better body chemistry and better health, you need to keep an eye on the big picture. Want some help managing your glycemic health without drugs? Visit the Pressing Sugar Spikes library page on the Better Body Chemistry blog. And whilst you're there, grab the free HbA1c tracker so that you can begin the journey today to creating better body chemistry and better health. Here is one of the references that I've used to tell today's story. For the rest, click through to the blog post. Know someone who is sugar watching? Share this video with them so they understand what the HbA1c test is measuring, so that they can make sure that it's working for them. And if this is your first time here, be sure to subscribe to our channel so you catch future episodes of Better Body Chemistry TV. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Remember, small things can make a big difference to your health.